reading about dreams. And I do think at this time in our history right now, dreaming is so vital for our survival. And I have to say that it's natural, it's normal. Everybody is dreaming, you know? I mean, they say death and taxes. Oh yeah, everybody does death and taxes. But now death and taxes, and add dreaming to that, all right? And I do want to share with you some stories that are from a lot of creative individuals. We have writers and inventors, scientists, but you know what? Just in case we're just like regular folks going to work every day, you know, having our dreams, dreams are for everybody. They are for everybody. And there's always messages. You know, I have a lot of people come up to me and say, well, what about those dreams after I had a whole pizza? And, you know, they're really kind of ordinary and kind of boring, you know. It's like, well, that's okay. I do think that when we start listening to our dreams, it's like, knock, knock, knock. There's some messages. And I think it's so important that when we start to listen to them, a whole door opens up. And I think it's that little secret handshake with the universe that says, oh, they're listening. Okay, you know what? I got a lot to tell you right here, okay? So the thing is that dreaming cultures and civilizations have been around for thousands of years. This is nothing new, nothing new, really. And so I have to start with probably the oldest dreaming civilization is the Aborigines. And so we're talking about like 65,000 years ago, their dream time. Civilization and culture was really based on everything that they put together as far as their understanding of the cosmos and how it helped inform them of what was, what is, and what will be. And so dreaming cultures have been around for centuries. Okay, so let's talk about the Celts, the Greeks, Chinese, Japanese, Egyptians, Hebrews, they all have dreaming cultures where they have created temples, where they will go into, say, either a cave or a temple and ask for a dream. I have this project I'm working on. I have this emotional issue that needs to be healed. Ask for a dream. I mean, in the Greek Asclepius tradition, people would go through all these wonderful rituals of cleansing and smelling these beautiful herbs and deep meditation and prayer. And then they would go into the healing temples and ask for the dream. And that dream would speak to their heart and would say, this is what you need to know right now. And, you know, I have to say that it's unfortunate in our time that what's happened through that whole prognosis of that evolution of dreaming, that it's such an inner conversation with our subconscious. I mean, that is, it's a very personal thing and it's a very illuminating thing all at the same time. So the one thing is that dreams fell out of favor. They, you know, I have to say the early church, they got a hold of that and it's like, well, we don't want you to have the authority. We have to take that away. Dreaming can't be your authority because we have to set us up as we're the authority in your life as far as connecting to that greater power. So, you know, we have to say, you'll have to just put that aside. And you know, you have to be very careful because in the old days, you could have been called a heretic, a witch, whatever. And they did not want any of those people around questioning their authority. And so then science comes along and says, you know what? Dreams mean nothing. They're just a bunch of neural firings in your brain. And it's zing, zing. It's going all over the place. And there's nothing about it. And then here we get to our Western society. And then, you know, what happened is that people are saying, you know, oh, it's only a dream. It doesn't have any meaning. It doesn't mean anything. It's just a bunch of night theater and it's weird and it's only a dream. Just go back to sleep. You know, and here's these little frightened kids going, ah, it's just a dream. I don't think so. that monster was really after me. So the thing is, what I want to share with you today is that these great dreams from inventors, and I'll start with Elias Howe. And I think that we've all been very much partaking of his invention just these last couple of weeks, because we're all busy making masks, you know, for the COVID virus. And Elias Howe was an inventor, and he put together a sewing machine. And, you know, the thing is, I have to say that there were several people working on coming up with the sewing machine. And none of them got it right. They had lots of problems with this sewing machine. And you know what? Those tailors, they didn't want to have anything to do with this guy, because of course that would take out a lot of jobs. And here's all these women sewing, you know, by hand, very slow. So the thing is, he had some supporters and a guy that funded him, but he was very slow. He couldn't seem to get the needle right and all that, but he had a dream. Okay. So he's in this dream and he's taken prisoner by a lot of natives, and they're furiously dancing around him, you know. And then he looks up while he's in this dream and he notices they have these spears, and they just seem to have a little hole at the top part of the spear. And he goes, wow. I'm sure he said, wow, that's pretty interesting. He woke up right away and said, you know what, I gotta write this down. And so he immediately, he couldn't get back to sleep, went down to his studio, whatever you call those, and put in the needle, the hole right at the very tip. And he got his machine to work. And so he was the one that was awarded the patent. And when he passed away and his sons took it over and eventually went bankrupt, Isaac Singer took over his machine. And so we all know about Singer sewing machines, which we've been feverishly working on making our masks this week. So I want to just share with you one of the oldest dreams that's recorded in history. And, you know, I always wonder, like, here is this guy, he's walking around in the desert. His name is Thutmose IV from Egypt. And he is wandering around in the desert for a hunting trip. I'd like to know what he was hunting on the desert, you know? So here he comes upon, if you can imagine this, here he comes upon this giant head of a pharaoh, just the head, okay? So out in the desert, he goes, you know, I gotta go to sleep, just take a nap. And he's looking for some shade. So he happens to fall asleep in the shade of the Sphinx. So what a great place to go to sleep. If you can imagine all the, you know, if they say, if these walls could talk. So if the Sphinx could talk, what would it have to say? So that's such an interesting idea. So he has this dream. And in the dream, the Sphinx says, you know, if you could clear away all the sand and move it out and restore myself, I will make you king. And so Thutmose IV says, whoa, that's a great idea. That's a bargain I can live with, right? So he clears away all of the sand, and the Sphinx is huge. It's huge. And he sees the paws and everything from the Sphinx. And he becomes the 8th pharaoh of the 18th dynasty. And, you know, this is about 1400 BC. So it's very old. It's the first recorded dream in history. And so to honor his dream, and I love this, that he honored the dream, he made this beautiful carved headstone that sits right in the middle of the Sphinx's paws. So if anybody's ever been to Egypt, and you know what, you could look this up on Wikipedia and see this beautiful, it's called a dream stele, and it's right in the middle of the paws. And it tells Thutmose IV's story about how he was crowned king and how he cleared away the Sphinx. And, you know, I have to say, I think it's going to be really interesting when we start having more dreams about what is the purpose of the Sphinx? What is it guarding? What is it hiding? What's the purpose of the Sphinx? I am really, I'm on it. I can't wait to hear that information. And I'm hoping that eventually some more dreams will come through to say, hey, I've been here all these centuries, and guess what news I've got to tell you. So I am really hoping that will come. Now, I want to tell you about this other story that is pertinent to our story, which is in America. Abraham Lincoln was president. He was right in the middle of Civil War. There was a lot of chaos. And he was about trying to get the 13th Amendment passed. This was an important amendment. And we're really lucky that here's a president who's really into listening to his dreams. And what happened was the cool thing is, he had a journal. He wrote this all down. And so we have the benefit of reading his notes from his journal. So he has this dream. And in the dream, he hears all this sobbing and weeping and wailing. So he gets up. And in the dream, he's walking around the White House, walking in and out of the hall, opening doors, trying to say, where's all that noise coming from? Where is the weeping? So he makes his way down to the East Room. He opens the door, and that's where all the women are that are weeping. So he sees the soldiers, and lo and behold, right smack in the middle of the East Room is this raised platform with a coffin. And he just looks at the guard and goes, who's died in the White House? And the soldier, he looks at him and goes, the president has been assassinated. And, I'm sure that really ruined his dream that night. But he immediately woke up and he said, he wrote this all in his journal. And it's great that we could read this. And he goes, you know what? It was only a dream, only a dream. But he was really annoyed. He was annoyed with the whole thing. But, the thing that's amazing to me is that he had this dream. He saw, it could have been me. And it could have been that I might not be here much longer. So I do think that having this information gave him the impetus to really push for the 13th Amendment to be passed. Because this is my opinion, that I think he knew that if he didn't do it, no one else would. No one else would. So I wrote a song for Lincoln's dream, and I'm going to share that with you now. Thank you. I'm going to share a story with you now that is more modern. And you know what? I have to say, this has totally revolutionized our lives. It has changed history so totally. I think that we don't even know how much it has. So Larry Page is a computer scientist. And you know what? He had been working on computers and working on how to assemble a working web information system and how to make it so that it can translate and connect to other larger systems and finding the right algorithm for that. And so, of course, one night he had a dream. And so in the dream, he is given this information about downloading the whole World Wide Web and seeing how it can evolve to be a search engine. And in Google now is, you know, it's a word that everybody knows, and we Google that and Google this, and have you been Googled? And, you know, so it's on our tongue, it's on our speech. And so another guy that has contributed to the computer science world is Jeff Taylor. So this is a guy who also had his fingers in the pie as far as doing computer work already. And he was involved with trying to create systems that, with his corporate sponsorship of trying to meet people and match them up and everything. And so he has this dream where he sees himself putting together an electronic bulletin board and how it can be used to get people connected to look for jobs. And so he woke up from this dream. He said, oh my God, this is fabulous. He woke up, he was so excited, he couldn't get back to sleep. He goes to the nearest cafe, starts writing it down feverishly. And then that very night, 4:30 in the morning, I mean, you have to be really excited to actually get out of bed, you know. He did have this great habit of writing stuff down. And I think this is really interesting of a lot of people who are trying to keep tabs on ideas. They'll put a pad and pencil by their bed, and if they have that idea, they'll just jot it down. And sometimes just a sentence or two will manifest to be a great idea. So these two guys really changed our personal lives and the world. They listened to their dreams. They took the chance to listen to their dreams. And I think that they opened themselves up to saying, well, they were at a place where they were ready to hear it and ready to say, I've got all these pieces of the puzzle, but I'm missing this. And this is what I love about that little secret handshake of the universe that says, I got it. It's right over here. It's in your dream, you know? So another person I want to share his story with is Albert Einstein. And as a culture, I think that we were really tremendously fortunate to be gifted with his E=mc². And this was such a groundbreaking achievement for Albert Einstein. And, you know, he also was working on it, but he even told a colleague, he said, you know what, I'm working on this project and it's like on the tip of my tongue, but I don't have it all put together yet. I'm not there yet, but I can feel it, it's coming, right? So he goes to sleep one night, has a dream. Okay, so his dream, he's sledding down the mountainside fast, really fast. I do sound effects. Okay, so it's really fast down the mountainside. And amazingly, what happens is that the stars in the sky, they change, you know, and I don't know, I kind of interpret it like, you know, if you're watching Star Trek and they go to warp 9 or something, you know, how zoom, it all changes. So Albert Einstein is looking at this dream where all the stars in the sky, they change in relationship to him. And so he wakes up from this dream, and I think he put it all together from that dream. And so I have a song I want to share with you about Einstein's dream.
Thank you.
I think that people who maybe had a different take on vampires, when Stephanie Meyer came along and wrote her song, not song, but wrote her book, and came, of course it was a TV series called Twilight, that we probably all have a different view of vampires now. And so she had a dream about this whole plot. The whole story was laid out in the dreams. And she thought, these are very strange. They're strange enough, you know what? I better write this stuff down. And so, well, here we are, you know? And people just have different takes on vampires. And I think it's because of her, you know? And so how did this change history? Well, maybe not every, like the global history, but for a lot of personal history, people thought, vampires, wow, I love that guy, you know, even though he was kind of spooky. So another woman who wrote, just because of a challenge, she was challenged to write a ghost story. So she has a dream one night, and in this dream, she sees this mechanical type of monster guy that's really tall, and of course the little stitches here, and she calls him Frankenstein. And her name was Mary Shelley, and she had never written anything before, but this came to her as an image, and the whole story kind of just was laid out in front of her, and she just went with it, and part of a ghost story. So I think we all think of, you know, lovingly of Frankenstein, because you know what, this whole genre started the sci-fi thrillers, and Mary Shelley, she nailed it. You know, Frankenstein is that archetypal monster that, you know, we probably all grew up with. Oh man, is he under the bed? Oh gosh, I gotta think about that. So well, I want to tell you another field that is really imbued with dreams and visions are religions. And there's many, many dreams that have come to us in the Bible. And also, I want to just tell you a little bit about St. Patrick, because my Irish connection, I guess. So St. Patrick, you know, he was taken as a slave and brought to Ireland. And he spent many a night as a shepherd, and he did finally escape. And the thing is that being out on the mountainside and just in this just pure, beautiful scenery, I think that he got more sensitive to listening inside and listening to his dreams. And he had this wonderful dream where this monk handed him some letters. And in the letters, in his dream, he's reading them. And this is a really interesting part of the dream, is that he's reading the words and he's also hearing the voices at the same time, because he's hearing the voices of the Irish crying, say, come back to walk among us, come back to help us. And he's hearing it. So of course, he came back to Ireland and was able to connect with them so profoundly, because he was, he used to live there, and he knew the psyche of the Irish. And even though the pagan Irish chieftains would challenge him, they kind of left him alone. And then slowly, a lot of people were converted to Christianity because of him in Ireland. So another religious tradition that really just totally respects dreams is the Muslim society. And I have to say that this is a really interesting take for us, because this is a situation that did not only change our world, but it changed the whole world globally. So Osama bin Laden, when he was laying out plans for the airplanes to go to the Twin Towers, he had his members of Al-Qaeda and only gave them just a little snippet of the plot. He didn't tell them the whole thing. He just said, you know, this is your part. You need to focus on this. And this is what you're going to be doing in this big plan that we're doing. but what happened? And this is something he did not count on, is that they started dreaming of the whole thing. They started dreaming of what was going to take place. Now, some of them knew that they were going to be flying planes or whatever, and but not everybody. Not so what happened is a lot of those guys in Al-Qaeda who were chosen to do some of the tasks, they were out. It's like, no, you can't know the whole plot because you're going to blow our story. That's what's going to happen. So when 9/11 happened, I have to say this was such a monumental dreaming thing that happened, is that people all around the globe were dreaming of 9/11. And they were dreaming of it probably a year before it happened. They were dreaming it of months before it happened. And even my own mother dreamt of two tall buildings and seeing fire on top. And people were having these dreams, and it was like, they couldn't make sense out of them. It's like, what? What is that? And so when 9/11 happened, people were so specific with their dreams. It was amazing. They could totally outline everything that happened with all the planes and all the scenarios that played out. And it was a pretty scary thing. So, but all the religions, you know, they are definitely, you know, cued in to dreams and visions. That is part of their culture. And I think for the most part, they had to be very careful with even probably today saying, yeah, I had a dream. I listened to the voice of God or whatever. She was like, oops, got to watch out. So I'm hoping that as we share more about dreams, that we'll become more of a dreaming culture. And I do think that it's so important now that we are at a place where it's so chaotic in out there, that we have to have that respite in here. And dreams can afford us the answers in that calm place. And I do think that in the crazy chaos of the waters, we need to drop anchor in the dreams and go inside and learn that we can empower ourselves by listening to our own personal and sometimes collective information that we get from dreams. So I want to share with you another story. Harriet Tubman was an abolitionist. She was very active politically and an activist, and she really tried to make a difference in the world. She was a slave. And the interesting thing about her is that she came from the African Ashanti tradition, which they are known as dream trackers. For centuries, they've been known as dream trackers. So I think she inherited that gift from them. But unfortunately, what happened was, you know, here she was being a slave, and her overseer threw this 2-pound ball of lead, whack, and it was supposed to go right beside her and hit the guy that was running out the door, but it hit her right smack in the head. And, you know, people who look back on Harriet Tubman think, oh, I wonder if she had narcolepsy or what she had. But what happened was all of a sudden she started having dreams and visions. And she would get these tremendous headaches. And then all of a sudden she just plopped to the ground. And then she'd wake up. Okay. So she escaped slavery. And she decided, you know what, I'm going back. I am going to rescue as many slaves as possible. And so because she had this problem where she would just kind of blank out and she would plop down on the road or wherever, she took a group of slaves that she was going to rescue, and she could hear the people coming for them. And they were close by enough to hear them. She got this tremendous headache and then just plopped down in the middle of the road. And what happened was when she started doing this, she would start flying in her dreams. She would be flying overhead, and she would be seeing the routes of where she could take her slave friends, right? And she could take this route or that route. And because she had an aerial view, that gave her the advantage. So I was really pleased when I saw the Harriet Tubman movie that they showed that scene where she's rescuing these slaves. She plops down on the middle of the road and goes, oops, you know what? I'm not going that way. I'm going this way. And they all made it safely. So she rescued about 300 slaves. And so did she change the world? Well, I like to think that she opened up a lot of opportunities for those people. And for each person that she saved, she definitely changed their world. She changed their world. Share with you another story about this Russian scientist called Dmitry Mendeleev. Now, he was also working on projects, and I think it's really interesting listening to all these inventors or scientists. They're working, and they have that missing puzzle. So Dmitry Mendeleev was working on trying to organize the elements of the universe. And each element, calcium, magnesium, beryllium, all of these have compounds that he was trying to organize in a united type fashion that made sense. So he went on vacation. All his family played music. They're all four of them. They're all playing music. And he thought, oh, this is terrible. This sounds awful. They're not going to get it together. And awful. So I think I'm just going to take a nap because I don't hear any harmony. It's awful. So he takes a nap and he has this dream where he sees the elements and they're all kind of coalescing in a template and in a pattern. And he sees that because of the atomic numbers that each of these elements have, he sees how these elements are lining up in a pattern. And he wakes up and he writes it all down. And the thing is that he creates the periodic table of elements. And the amazing part about it was that because he was able to put it into a cohesive, organized pattern, he was able to name five more elements that hadn't even been found yet. And I think it's really interesting now that the periodic table is expanding. So we're actually finding rare earth elements and adding to his original design of the periodic table. So, you know, one thing that I want to stress is it sounds like all these dreams help inventors. They've got these big dreams and they help the writers finish and write these great stories. But you know what? The one thing is that dreaming is for everybody. And remember, it's free. It's natural. It's for everybody. And so I like to think that when we want to connect with our dreams, that we can get the information we need. And just to share that with you is that this one woman who had a dream where she, in the dream, she had somebody pointing a gun at her breast. And she said, I don't like that. I don't like that at all. So the thing is, she was able to listen to that dream and say, you know what? I think I better get that checked out. And so she, because she listened to that dream, she saved her life because she found this cancer in that right breast, just right exactly where the gun was pointing. And they were able to find it so early. She was completely healed. And I have to tell you too, that there's this man who was, this is his dream. He's in the dream and he's at a red light. Okay. Sitting at the red light. Da, 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 wait. Red light turns green. And then he goes, I can't put my foot on the gas. And this is his dream. I can't do it. I don't know. He wakes up. He's all frustrated. I don't know what that was all about. That's crazy. So the thing is, 2 months go by and he's sitting at a red light and he goes, whoa, this feels really familiar. He's looking around. This feels familiar. He's the first one in line. He sees the red light and the red light turns green. He goes, I can't put my foot on the gas. He kind of freezes up. He goes, oh no, this is just like my dream. And of course he didn't remember all the dream, but just then he says, well, I can't put my foot on the gas. I don't know what. And just then, a giant semi truck went right in front of him who lost his brakes. And so because he listened to that dream, of course, he's alive to tell us. So that's why I say that these dreams are not just for inventors and people writing stories and computer whizzes. They're for everybody. And we can listen to these dreams and it might someday change our life and it change lives of everyone around us. So I want to end with one of my favorite stories is that, okay, there's no secret that I am a big Beatle fan. Okay, totally into the Beatles, right? And Paul McCartney woke up one day and he's sitting at the breakfast table and he's kind of humming this little tune. And he goes, you know, I think I dreamt this, but I'm not sure. I wonder if I heard this somewhere. And he's gone, scrambled eggs, scrambled eggs. I kind of like that. But so what happened is he turns this little scrambled eggs, little riff into the most recorded song in history, which is Yesterday, the most recorded song in history. And you know what? I have to say, I'm glad that he wasn't eating oatmeal or bacon that day, that he had scrambled eggs. That was a perfect avenue for that melody to come through, scrambled eggs. All right, so I have to tell you my story about John Lennon. And before I tell you this story is that when I started working on getting all the, I wrote this song for John Lennon's dream. And as I was writing this, his music for this song and researching the information to verify his dream, I had dreams, three dreams of John Lennon. And John Lennon, you know, this is the thing that's so funny. It's like John Lennon in my dream said, I want you to tell my story. I'm like, okay, I will do it. So let's see, I have to make sure that I put John Lennon's story in this presentation. So John Lennon, okay, so in 1979, John Lennon has a dream. In his dream, he is out dining with his wife, Yoko Ono. And in the dream, here comes this chubby guy with glasses, right? And he comes up to them at their table. And, you know, I'm sure lots of people would come up to John Lennon. And he says to the chubby guy, he goes, you know, you got to prove you're not a nutcase because just you got to show me, you know, that you're cool. And so right then when he says that, the police come up to this chubby guy with the glasses and because they notice he has a handgun. And so right away, John Lennon wakes up. He didn't remember the rest of the dream. So that was in 1979. And in 1980, the early part of 1980, John Lennon has a dream. He's reading the obituary. He's reading his obituary. And he reads this obituary that says he was the perpetrator and the victim, that he was killed in a homicide, and that the perpetrator and the victim was him, and that he kept saying in the dream, but he wasn't guilty. He wasn't guilty. And so I have to say, in the December 8th in 1980, John Lennon was killed by a man who was a chubby guy with glasses. And this guy, he was a deranged fan. He so much wanted to be John Lennon that he married a Japanese wife. He collected art. And the night before the murder, he signs out of his job at his workplace. He signs his name as John Lennon. And yeah, so I wrote this song for John Lennon and for his dreams. And I tried to do this in kind of a 50s fashion, because he did love that kind of style music. So this is for John Lennon. Dream to change your life, because it will come knocking like gangbusters, all in good ways. That's why I think dreams are so important, because it's an inside job. We're listening to our subconscious talk to us. And it's like, well, you know, in the ancient days, people listened to those dreams because they were getting in touch with the divine. They were getting in touch with the greater part of ourself. And I think that, you know, I listen to Star Trek and it's like going out there, the final frontier. It's like, you know, the final frontier is really inside, to listen to our heart and to listen to our psyche. And what is our subconscious telling us? And how can we make this planet a better planet? How can we make our lives better to be of service to people and to learn how to love? And I think that dreams help us overcome our aversion to some of those things, I have to say, and to overcome some of our shortcomings and put us on the path of really, gosh, I can learn to love. I can be the best I can be. And I think dreams offer that. And it's free. It's natural. That's even the best part. Nobody can take that away. Well, I would just want to say thank you all so much for listening. I do appreciate it. And I always just like to tell people about dreams, because they're so mystical and magical. And gosh, it's like having a best friend around all the time, a best friend that's, you know, we don't mind having around all the time, a good guy. It's important that we feel that support. And dreams are just amazing. Wonderful feeling to be able to help people understand dreams, because it's it's not such a mystery, but you know, we are so blindsided. We can't see ourselves. And this is the amazing part of dreams, is that we can see other people and they are reflections. They are reflecting to us what we need to see and what we need to hear. And they also reflect back to us the love that we can give out or the fear that we feel as well. And so dreams work about us projecting our fears onto other people or our heartfelt sentiments to other people. And in dreams, that's what symbols are. Strange, weird, crazy symbols that happen in dreams. And one thing that I've learned that was just so amazing from Jeremy Taylor was that the whole science of projection is so helpful to know that if I take it out into my waking world, that if I see a friend and I go, oh gosh, I'm scared about what that's going to be like. You know what? Now I can say, you know what, star, I'm projecting. So it's made it inroads into a very practical method that helps me say, you know, I have to own my thoughts and my feelings and not project them on you. And so that is, boy, that's the side benefits of doing dream work. I think I will play another piece. I will play this piece. This is such a funny story. I live downtown Denver, but occasionally we have raccoons. And we used to have a raccoon that sat, made her little nest in my neighbor's loft, right under their loft. And I had a lucid dream where I was sitting on top of the garage and I had these little earrings and I was talking to this raccoon that was my neighbor's raccoon. You know, we'd sit out in the backyard, sit on the lounge chair, get some wine and watch her teach her little babies. She was so cute. So I named this piece Flora because I met her in my dream and she played with my little earrings and I asked her if I could, you know, pet her. And then she said, my name is Flora. Raccoons have names? That's odd. So I'll play you that song.
Thank you. All right.